And then when he even says Jesus into the world, the promised Messiah, the promised Savior, it shows even more how reckless God's love. He sends his only son to die for this nation, for these people, and ultimately for the whole world. Hey guys, Ashley here with Coffee and Bible Time. And if you are new to this channel, I just want to let you know that I am Ashley and I post Christian videos weekly. If you're new, I hope you would consider subscribing so that you can be notified when we come out with videos and so that you can join our family. We just came out with this sweatshirt for Black Friday. So, and then I have a few other things here that we came out with too. I'll have it linked in the bio, but this Plant Truth shirt, and Taylor designed it, so it's beautiful. Then my personal favorite is this journal, which I love to use during my quiet time and just to keep diving deeper with the Lord and just even like writing out prayers and everything like that. And I actually designed this. So yeah, if you guys want to support us, we are a small business and we are doing this as our job. So if you would like to support us, if you love Coffee and Bible Time, go check this out. And yeah, so this week's video is a hashtag CBT reading challenge video, and I'm so sorry that it's been so long since I've been on here for the hashtag CBT reading challenge, and I have been posting absolutely nothing for it on Instagram, and it's because life has gotten crazy. If you guys saw my last video, then you see that, yeah, everything is just crazy right now. I've just been so behind on updating you guys with the CBT reading challenge, and that's why I want to come with here. I want to give you guys a video to help encourage you to keep going on the CBT reading challenge. I have not quit. I am still trying to read through the Old Testament. I currently have made it through Jeremiah, and so I'm on Ezekiel now. If you are behind, that's okay. Keep going. You can do this. If you're way, way, way behind, that's okay. Keep going. You can do this. You guys, I'm serious. It's okay if you fall off track. After this video's over, get your Bible out and keep reading through it. If you don't know anything about the hashtag CBT reading challenge, I will have that link down below. We're just reading through the Old Testament. Sorry, I've been talking for 5 years. Let's get into the video. For this video, I created a timeline. So yeah, so what this video is about, Let me backtrack why I created this. So the first time I ever read through the Old Testament, it was a struggle bus because I read through it, Genesis all the way through to the end of the Bible, and I didn't understand the history or the background of the Old Testament. I didn't understand that it was written a long time ago and that we need to read it not as if it's today times. And I didn't know that. I was young. I was in middle school when I started reading through the Bible. And yeah, so now that I've been reading through the Bible a second time, my eyes are open because I'm actually going through an Old Testament class at my school at Moody. And my mind is blown because as I read through it, I'm like, this makes so much sense in the context that it's supposed to be in. It's crazy. But yeah, it makes so much sense. And I'm like, this changes everything about reading through the Bible when you know the history, when you know the context, when you know the general overarching timeline of the Old Testament. It will change everything. I'm not even kidding. And so yeah, I'm just gonna walk you through the timeline I created, and I will have this free on my website linked down below. So go check that out if you want to get this printed out and have it in your Bible as you're reading through the Old Testament. So I put here first God. God was before everything. God existed always. He's the great I am. And we can't wrap our heads around that. I can't wrap my head around that. God has always been and always will be. And so that's why I put God there at the beginning. And so then we start in Genesis, and this is the beginning of time. It's crazy, you guys, that we have an account written down of the beginning of time. That's awesome. That is just so cool. It blows my mind. And so that is creation. And that is when God created mankind, and that is when the fall happened. That is when Adam and Eve chose to sin and rebel and turn away from God. And so then we have the flood. God decided to flood the whole world. It was wicked. Everyone was wicked, but he chose to save Noah and his family because of his faith. And then we start getting into the dates. And these dates I actually got from my Old Testament survey class. Dr. Sanchez gave us these dates, and so I take no credit for these dates. Thank you, Dr. Sanchez, for these dates. And this is just a general dating of the Old Testament. Obviously, we don't know 100 million quadrillion percent sure if these exact dates are the exact dates, but we do have a pretty sure chance that this is closely around these times. And so, yeah, so at 2166 BC, we have Abraham. And so God chose Abraham. God created a covenant with Abraham because he wasn't giving up on the world. He wasn't giving up on us as a people who have turned away from him. And then he gives birth to Isaac, and then Isaac gives birth to Jacob and Esau. God chose Jacob, and he had 12 sons, and those 12 sons ultimately become the 12 tribes of Israel. And so then we see in 1876 that they had to go to Egypt because of the famine. And then there was 400 years of being in Egypt, and that is when they became slaves. The Israelite people became slaves. Another book that is written during the time of Genesis is Job. And we think that Job is written during that time for many reasons and hints in the book. And then from there, 1446, about 400 years later, they exited Egypt by Moses. God raised up Moses to deliver them, to save them. And then that is when Moses meets with God at Mount Sinai, and God establishes a covenant with his people there, the Ten Commandments. And just God really coming to his people and saying, this is how you need to live as my people. You need to be holy. And then for 40 years, you see how rebellious they were. They were wandering in the wilderness. That was their punishment. And then finally, they are able to enter Canaan in 1406. And it's the promised land. God had been promising them that they can enter this amazing, beautiful land. And finally, 40 years after wandering, they were able to enter the promised land. And Joshua was the leader for this. During these dates in the Bible, the books that correspond with this are Exodus, Numbers, and Joshua. And other books that also correspond are Leviticus and Deuteronomy. So all these books correspond with these dates and what's going on here. So then moving on, we have Judges and 1 Kings. And in 1350, the Judges led Israel, and they led Israel for about 300 years till 1051 BC. And then Saul becomes king, then David becomes king, then Solomon becomes king. And all throughout this time, the books that go along with this are Judges, 1 Kings. Ruth is written during Judges. And then Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Song of Solomon are written during this time, during Saul's reign, David's reign, Solomon's reign. All those books were written during this time. So as you're reading those books, you want to remember that they were written during Judges and 1 Kings as you're reading through those. And then we get into 2 Kings and 1 and 2 Chronicles. And in 931 BC, the kingdom split. So Israel is in the north and Judah is in the south. So that whole kingdom split. And that is why, as you're reading through, you'll sometimes see references to only Judah or only to Israel. And I used to get so confused during that part when I was reading through those parts, and I was like, what is happening? Who is Judah? Who is Israel? And during in the book 2 Kings, you see that those two kingdoms split after Solomon's death, which is really sad because God's people were supposed to be God's people, a united nation, but they split, and that was due to sin and due to the corruptness of the kings. So in about 722 BC, the Assyrians attacked the northern kingdom of Israel, which is also known as Samaria. Samaria was like their capital. And so in 722, first Israel falls. And so Judah is still a nation, still going strong. But then in 586 BC, Babylon attacks Jerusalem and Judah fell. And so it's interesting because Judah could have looked at their older sister, Israel, and seen, oh my gosh, they just fell. We need to turn our ways, turn back to the Lord and follow him. But they didn't do this. And the reason why these two kingdoms fell and were taken over by other nations was because of their disobedience, was because they weren't following the Lord. They weren't obeying him. And they were partaking in so much idolatry and so much whoredom against God that God had to do something to turn them back to him. And during 2 Kings and 1 and 2 Chronicles, we see the prophets of the Assyrian age. And so when right before the whole Israel fell to Assyria, and during that time, Amos and Hosea are prophesying to Israel. Isaiah and Micah are prophesying to Judah, and Jonah is prophesying to foreign nations. So all those minor prophets and major prophets in the Old Testament are written during 2 Kings or 1 and 2 Chronicles. And so then we get to the prophets during the Babylonian age, and that is Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Jeremiah, Daniel, Ezekiel. And those prophets were written to Judah. Those prophets were writing to Judah right before they fell, right before Babylon, them telling them, return, repent, return to the Lord. But they didn't. And so they prophesied and said, you will be taken over by Babylon. And then Nahum, that book, is to foreign nations as well. And then we get on to 2 Chronicles, Ezra, and Nehemiah, which we see that for 70 years, there were 70 years of captivity that the Israelites were stuck in Babylon. And then we even see that Babylon, the nation that took over Israel, fell to Persia. And that's when 538, the King Cyrus of Persia lets the Jews return home. And he lets little amounts of Jews return home every so often. So not all of Israel, not all of Judah goes back, but little spurts go back. And that's when they start to rebuild the temple. And then in 457, Ezra starts to revive the law and God's word and saying, we need to keep the law. We need to turn back to God. And then in 445 BC, Nehemiah rebuilds the wall. He rebuilds the wall around Jerusalem. Because remember, they were taken captive. The whole temple had fallen. Everything was gone. Everything was destroyed. But Nehemiah starts to rebuild that wall. I love that book. And then during this time, the prophets of the Persian age are Haggai, Zechariah, Joel, and Malachi. And they are prophesying to Judah specifically. And then Obadiah is prophesying to foreign nations during that time. And then after that, we see 400 years of silence where God didn't have prophets. There was just silence during that time. And then the birth of Jesus, his death and resurrection. And that starts the New Testament. And what I love about this is that God's love is reckless. And I write that down because You see, at the beginning of creation, at the beginning of mankind, we turn away from God. We rebel against him. And then over and over and over again, we rebel. The judges period, they're in a period of rebellion. Most of the kings of Israel are evil. Many of the kings of Judah are evil. They turn away from God. They bow down to foreign man-made gods of wood and stone. And God is saying, I am here. I just want to love you. I just want to be your God because I created you and I love you and I called you for a purpose. And so these people who turned away from God had no, God did not have to save them. God did not have to rescue them. God did not have to call them back. Like, God could have said, I'm done. You've turned away so many times. You've cheated on me so many times. I don't want anything to do with you. But instead, God says, no, I'm going to patiently love them. And yes, I'm going to discipline them, but guess what? I'm going to call them back to my heart. And then when he even says Jesus into the world, the promised Messiah, the promised Savior, it shows even more how reckless God's love. He sends his only son to die for this nation, for these people, and ultimately for the whole world, for a whole world that has turned against God. He sends his son to die for them. And that is why it is so important to read through the Old Testament and to know the history of it, to know the overall arc of this story, because that is going to help you so much as you read through the Old Testament and the New Testament. It's going to help you so much understand Jesus more, understand his ministry more, understand the Jewish culture more, everything about it. And it starts with just knowing that overall arc, even before you start diving into individual passages. It's so important to know this. And so that's why I want to give this as a free resource for you guys if you go check it out on my blog. And I hope that all made sense. I hope that this helps you as much as it did help me open your eyes as you're reading through the Old Testament. And I hope the hashtag CBT reading challenge goes amazing. Keep going, keep focusing on the Lord, especially during this Christmas season. So yeah.